my name is Brian Tsuchida. I'm the Chief Magistrate Judge for the Western District of Washington. And as a sitting judge, I'm often asked a couple questions. In particular, how do you become a judge? And after meeting a lot of people, I came to realize what people are really asking me are, well, what's your story? What is it about your background that led to you being selected as a magistrate judge? And then also, do you have any concrete tips about the process? Well, my story, like the story of many Americans, starts over 100 years ago with grandparents who immigrated to the country. You know, simple country folk with not much else other than the gumption to make a go of things. And it was a tough go. Money was tight, opportunities were limited. Desegregation in this country was many, many, many decades away. It was a time of war, a time of mass incarceration. It was a time in which it seemed an impossibility for an Asian of American descent to ascend to the federal bench. But that impossibility became a reality in 2008 when I was selected to serve as United States Magistrate Judge in Seattle, Western District of Washington. First Asian American to serve as a judicial officer, federal judicial officer in the state of Washington. And I remember when I had my investiture that my aunt, who was then about 96 years old, came up to me and said, "You know, Brian, when I was growing up, my father said, we're never going to make it." And I can't really believe it, but you've done it. So that's my story. And when people ask me about my background, I tell them, you know, that is my story, but each of you have your own story. And there are many, many different paths that one could take to become a magistrate judge. But all of the paths lead to one place, and that would be a merit selection panel. And I say this because every single district in this country selects magistrate judges using a merit selection panel, a group of citizens, lawyers, folks not directly connected to the court who gather and interview and present to the court candidates they believe have the ability to serve as a magistrate judge.
I'm Julie Sneed. I'm a United States federal magistrate judge in the Middle District of Florida, and I work in the Tampa Division. I was raised in Florida. I've always lived in sunny Florida by a single parent mother. She raised four of us, my two brothers and my sister and I, single-handedly, really. It wasn't easy. She worked really hard, and we didn't have much, but we always had enough. She raised us by herself, and she really raised us to be good kids, to be honest kids, and she also raised us to understand really the importance of hard work, because she worked really, really hard. In my education, she really, really stressed that, and she really encouraged us to, you know, be good kids and to work hard in school. And she raised us somehow in a middle-class environment, even though, as I mentioned, she didn't have much. And all of the kids in my school, where I lived, were going to college. And really, that's, I think, one of the primary reasons that I ended up in going to college. All of the kids that were smart went to college. And so even though I didn't know how on earth I was going to afford college, I knew I would be going to college. And so I did attend the University of Florida, which is really the premier school in Florida. And then I attended law school at the Florida State University, which is another excellent school in Florida. After law school, I was very fortunate and obtained a very prestigious clerkship with a state appellate court judge, and then a prestigious clerkship with a federal district court judge. Did really well in those clerkships, worked really hard to impress them and to try to do a good job. And then after that, decided that I wanted to go into private practice, which I did, and earned a partnership title in private practice, and then went on to be the co-chair of the diversity committee, as well as serve on the hiring committee. So really had a wonderful career practicing law for 20 years before joining the bench.
My name is Mac McCoy. I have the honor and privilege of serving as a United States Magistrate Judge in the Middle District of Florida. I also have the distinction of being the first openly gay person to be appointed to the federal bench in the Middle District of Florida. A little bit about my background. I actually grew up in the community where I now serve. I grew up in the most economically depressed area of the community where I now serve, an area called Suncoast Estates. So I grew up very poor. My family struggled throughout my entire childhood, and this community is about 5 miles from the courthouse where I now go to work every day as a magistrate judge. And it's quite humbling to think that 40 years ago I was a kid playing in a sand pile in that community. While his parents worked day and night just to put food on the table. But by virtue of growing up in a very economically depressed area of our community, I began to view the law very early on as an instrument of oppression. And I think that's common for a lot of folks who grow up in economically deprived circumstances. But interestingly, I viewed attorneys as being problem solvers, individuals who were highly trained, who could bring their skills, knowledge, and abilities to help those who were in need. That eventually led me to go to law school, where for the very first time, I joined an LGBT student body organization. It was the first time in my life that I openly identified as being a gay person. And I learned a lot from that experience and a great deal of camaraderie with my fellow LGBTQ students in law school. I went to a very small law school, so there were very few of us there. At the end of the day, I was inspired through that involvement to pursue the best possible legal career I could attain. At that time, even though it was really in the late 90s, early 2000s, I was being told that I could not have a big firm job because I was openly gay. I was being told that certain opportunities would be foreclosed to me because I was openly gay, and I was discouraged from pursuing them. Being the stubborn person that I am, I pursued them nevertheless. I studied for the bar, passed the bar, and then by sheer luck obtained a 2-year clerkship with the United States Magistrate Judge in the Middle District of Florida, Tampa Division. That was one of the best experiences of my legal career, and it really inspired me. The judge that I worked for was one of the first African-American judges to serve in the state of Florida, in the 11th Circuit, and in the Middle District of Florida. So she herself was a trailblazer. Oftentimes, as a member of a minority group, we tend to hold ourselves back. We tend to think of ourselves as second-class citizens or not deserving of the same opportunities as others. And I think it's part of the professional growth of many individuals who come from minority groups, and perhaps women as well, to have to overcome that self-imposed mental barrier. And that was definitely part of my story. After finishing my clerkship for 2 years with my judge, I applied for one of the best law firms in Tampa Bay, thinking that there was no way I was ever going to get an associate position at that law firm. Everyone wanted to work at that law firm. I had fantastic interviews. I enjoyed meeting everyone, and I still thought, there's no way they're going to hire me because of who I am. I got an offer, and I ended up working with some fantastic lawyers who were at the top of their field. They mentored me throughout the course of my legal career, and I stayed at that firm for 12 years before I even thought about leaving, only for the opportunity to join the bench. In 2015, I woke up one morning, and as was my habit, I reached for my cell phone to look at my incoming emails. And the first email in my inbox was an email from the Federal Bar Association, the Tampa Bay chapter of the Federal Bar Association, announcing 2 vacancies for magistrate judge positions, one in Tampa, where I was practicing law, and one in Fort Myers, where I had grown up, where my family still lived. My extended family all still lived there. So I thought to myself, this must be a sign. There are 2 vacancies to serve as a United States Magistrate Judge, a position that I have long honored because I clerked for a magistrate judge. And I still had that doubt in the back of my mind. So I read the email, read the vacancy notices. I deleted the email. 2 days later, came back, undeleted the email, deleted the email again, undeleted it again. And I had this persistent question in my mind as to whether it was something that I should pursue. I went to lunch with a very good friend of mine who parenthetically eventually applied to become a magistrate judge herself and succeeded. And she is a person that I respected a great deal. And she simply asked me, do you think you would apply to be a magistrate judge? And I had all sorts of excuses as to why I might not want to apply. But she looked me square in the eye and said, I think you'd be great at it. And that was the first time anyone had really expressed that level of confidence in me in terms of pursuing an opportunity on the bench. So I went back to my office and decided to undelete that email again and to pursue in earnest the application process. So I gave the application process my all, and clearly it was successful because I now have the privilege of serving as a magistrate judge.
My name is Shanique Maynard, and I am a magistrate judge in the Southern District of Florida. I sit in the Fort Pierce Division. My roots in Fort Pierce are very deep. My father was the 11th son of 12 children, the seventh son of seven boys, born in a two-room house not even 2 miles from the courthouse that I'm now privileged to serve in. My grandparents didn't have a lot. They were the grandchildren of slaves living the realities of the Jim Crow South. My grandfather picked fruit in the citrus groves alongside his 12 children. And my grandmother was according to the census, a domestic servant, which I know means she cooked and cleaned for other people while trying to raise 12 kids of her own. They didn't have the opportunities that I've had. They didn't have the opportunity for education or advancement, but they understood the value of hard work, and they understood the value of an education. And they taught their children that, I remember my grandmother used to say, get your education because it's the one thing that once you have it, no one can ever take away from you. For me to be able to graduate from high school there and go on to Howard University and Yale Law School, I think really what is an extraordinary testament to how far we've come as a country and to the power of education to unlock any door. When I graduated from Yale Law School in 2001, the world was my oyster in many ways. I had clerked for a wonderful judge on the United States District Court for the District of Maryland, Judge Catherine Blake. And I had started at a law firm that was paying me more money than anyone in my family had ever seen. And I felt that I was on top of the world in a very traditional career path. In November of 2003, all of that changed when I got word that my 23-year-old brother had been shot and killed in Fort Pierce. Being victimized by violence really changes your life in a very profound way. It was like there was the time in my life before he was killed and then the time after. And it really caused me to look at the choices that I'd made and the pathway that I was on and to figure out if that was really the way that I was meant to impact the law and the justice system. The person who was accused of killing my brother, it took the system 2 years to bring that person to trial. By that time, evidence was lost, witnesses had moved, cops had moved on, and the case really fell apart, and that person was not convicted. And so to go through the process, not understanding the law, not understanding the case, not having a voice, but having all these professionals really impact your life in a pivotal way, and feeling voiceless made me want to do something about that and do something different with my life. Shortly after my brother, the person accused of killing him, was acquitted, someone else in my family who I loved very dearly was accused of a crime. And so really in the span of a few years, I found myself on both sides of a courtroom. One day, seeking justice on behalf of someone who I loved dearly, who'd been victimized, and then another day, seeking mercy from the court on behalf of someone that I loved. I went to the United States Attorney's Office as a federal prosecutor in Florida, and I handled lots of cases, but I generally gravitated towards those where there was a real victim whose life had been impacted and whose voice needed to be heard. And in each of those cases, it was really my honor to be able to represent those folks in the courtroom. 2012 or so, I found myself back as a prosecutor in Fort Pierce, where I'd grown up. And to my horror, the violence problems had gotten even worse. It was 10 years after my brother had been killed. There were even more victims. The perpetrators had gotten even younger. We had some incredibly horrendous murders committed. I really thought, while I love prosecuting crime, is there a way that we can impact this problem earlier, before lives have been ruined and people are either dead or facing long terms of imprisonment? So at that point, I think my career path really took a non-traditional turn, because I had the opportunity to leave what I was doing and lead a nonprofit that was focused on working with gang members. I remember when I told my mom, well, I think I'm not going to practice law anymore. I'm going to go take a pay cut and run this nonprofit and help guys in gangs. She was like, what? That's not what we sent you to law school for. But it really was, for me, almost a moment of, this has all been leading towards. Maybe this is what I was called to do. And so I left the job at the U.S. Attorney's Office and started running this nonprofit. And we helped young men ages 14 to 26 who were involved in gangs. We helped them get jobs. We helped them get back into school. We helped them complete probation, mental health counseling, substance abuse counseling, all of the above. And within 3 years, we saw violent crimes in our community go down by 40%, which is a statistic that I'm incredibly, incredibly proud of. I didn't know that pathway would lead to the bench. When the position came open in my community, the judge who was before me had served for 28 years. And someone said, oh, you know, the judge is retiring. You should think about applying. And I thought, they'll never hire me. I mean, I haven't been practicing law for 4 years. There's never been an African-American female judge in my county or the 5 counties around us. How could a little black girl who used to run by these canal banks barefoot become a judge? But I didn't give up. I put myself out there. I was reading this book called Lean In by Sheryl Sandberg at the time, and she asked the question, what would you do if you weren't afraid? And so I went for it. And I've been privileged and honored to serve in this position now for a year. I'm really excited about what the future holds, and I love this job.
My name is Alicia Valle, and I'm a magistrate judge in the Southern District of Florida. I serve in Fort Lauderdale, and I'm about to have my 5th year anniversary on the bench. This path to the bench started with my family. I was born in Cuba, and I lived there with my family. And when I was 8 years old, my parents decided that they needed to leave communist Cuba and search for a better life for my sister and me. So they packed up our bags, and the 5 of us left Cuba, my sister, myself, my parents, and my grandmother in tow. And we left with nothing. We had no money, we did not speak a word of English, we knew no one in the United States, and we came with everything we owned in one suitcase for the 5 of us. We attended public schools throughout. After high school, I went to Rutgers University. We lived in Jersey and graduated top of my class. I was very lucky to get accepted to Harvard Law School, where, again, I worked really hard to do the best I could, not just for me, but for my parents, because we owed them that much. After graduating law school, again, I was very lucky to get a wonderful clerkship, very highly sought after clerkship with the New Jersey Supreme Court. I clerked for a wonderful justice who's now retired, Justice Stuart Pollack. And I was the first Hispanic he had ever hired. And I knew that that was another big responsibility, that I had to do really good, really well, in order to keep that door open for others that came behind me. After that 1 year clerkship on the court, I went to practice in a civil commercial litigation firm, mid-size, in Newark. And after about 2.5 years in private practice, I realized that I wanted to do more, that I wanted to feel more fulfilled, and that I wanted to give back to the country that gave my parents and my family so much. So I became an assistant U.S. attorney in Newark. I worked in the New Jersey office in Newark for about 7 years. And after that, as all good Cubans, we wanted to end up in sunny Florida. So we moved to Miami, where I became an AUSA and spent the rest of my career in public service as an assistant United States attorney. I left the U.S. attorney's office only because this is the job that I dreamed of afterwards. I tried to get this job. I was committed to getting this job. On the third try, was a charm. And karma just has a way of coming back to you. We left Cuba on April 9th of 1969. And on April 9th of 2013, I got my dream job. I think one of the things that I tried to stress throughout this little presentation was how lucky I was. But as my favorite philosopher says, the harder I work, the luckier I get. And that philosopher, in case you're wondering, is Pitbull.